your thoughts on simulation theory. Or sorry, the simulation hypothesis.
Well, it's certainly the case that as computational systems have become more and more sophisticated, their ability to simulate the real world seemingly is getting better and better. We see this with, you know, going from video games to the most sophisticated, you know, virtual reality. And so certainly one can imagine that at some point in the future, we will have computational systems that are so sophisticated that they are able to have within them collections of bits and bytes running around that may themselves have self-awareness. Now, that's the big unknown. Can you have a computational system that is itself self-aware, that it has, you know, some sort of consciousness? That goes back to the question that we started with early on. I don't know the answer to that, but let's assume the answer is yes. Big assumption, but let's assume the answer is yes. Well, then you're in an interesting circumstance, because you can ask yourself, how many real universes in the sense of solid tables and chairs are there? Well, we're kind of aware of one, and it's very hard to create new ones. If I challenge you to create a new real universe, you don't know how to do it. Create a new Big Bang. I mean, nobody really knows how to do that. But if I ask you how many of these simulated universes are there, again, assuming that we've gotten to the point, say in the future, when we're able to simulate worlds of the conscious beings, there could be a gazillion simulated universes. You know, some kid just comes home late at night and flips on the computer and says, let me just simulate one more universe with these and these parameters. It just flips it up and the computer just simulates it. And within that simulation are further conscious beings. So then the question to ask yourself is, what's the likelihood that right now we are in a simulation? And if you sort of play the odds in the most naive way, you say, well, there's only one real universe, but there are gazillion, gazillion, gazillion of these simulated worlds. And so the odds would seem to suggest that we are in a simulated world just by sheer force of the numbers and probabilities. So do I believe that? Do I think that we are in a simulation right now? I can't say that I do. If you're to really challenge me why I don't really have a good response beyond the fact that I've never seen a simulation that can do this. But, you know, that may simply be that the simulator is so good that the simulator is hidden from me, the fact that I'm in a simulation. And I agree that if I extrapolate from where computation was 40 years ago to where it is today, sort of exponential growth in its ability to do things that seem real, then, you know, don't go 40 years hence, assuming we don't blow ourselves up, go 1,000 years hence. And now you can really imagine that there are these simulations and we could well be in one of them. So I don't feel like I have a strong refutation of the possibility that I'm in a simulation, but damn, I can't say that I think or believe that I am.
Man, thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure. I do have a last question from Charlie from the Institute for Arts and Ideas. He sent this to me and he's like, Curt, can you please, you're speaking to Brian, I would love if you could mention this. So I'll chat it here and I can say it aloud, if that's all right.
Yeah, sure.
I'll say it aloud just so that you can
My
read it.
My glasses on, so it's actually too, I can, okay, okay, why don't you read it?
Yeah, Charlie Barnett from the Institute of Arts and Ideas says, hi, Brian. Almost a year ago to this day, you were featured on a panel at the IAI, so the Institute for Arts and Ideas, with Michael Shermer, Sabine Hossenfelder, and Eric Weinstein. Eric Weinstein, who was a mathematical physicist at Harvard, said that string theory had a terrible culture in the 1980s that was in the process of resolving itself. In response to this, you sympathized and said that there was a sense of unreasonable exuberance, that many thought string theory was the final theory, but it also seemed that Eric was slightly exaggerating how bad the culture was. What do you think he was referring to, and could you maybe comment more broadly about how one can ensure that bias doesn't creep into scientific theories.
Yeah, I mean, you know, briefly put, there was a sentiment in the 80s. I mean, I was there as in thick of it as a graduate student, mostly, not as a faculty member. And there was a sentiment that we were approaching the end of physics. It was naive, but it was genuine. It wasn't as though people were making it up. I mean, you can't imagine, well, you can, but if you weren't actually part of it, perhaps one can't really feel the visceral excitement that had taken hold of a segment of the physics community. I mean, there I was, a graduate student at Oxford in 1984, 1985, and every Wednesday or something like that, when the preprints were finally delivered to the physics department, the graduate students, two others and myself in particular, we would like tear open the envelopes to see the next result. And we'd take that paper and compare it to what we were doing. We'd go upset and we were working like, you know, 15 hours a day. You know, I'd go to sleep at 2 a.m. I'd wake up at 7. I'd ride my bike to the physics because it was just like, oh my God, like it was all coming together, which is all just to say it was genuine. The excitement was genuine. But the downside of that kind of excitement is, if someone's not working on string theory at that time, I can well imagine they feel like a complete outsider, that they're completely excluded, that nobody cares about what they're working on or what they are doing. And I know people who have described that experience to me. And I don't know if that was Eric's experience or if there was something particular that happened. I just don't know. I don't know him personally. Sure, I've done that event and so forth. But I do know people who, from a more personal perspective, have described how alienated the excitement in the string theory community made them feel back in those days. And so I get it. And I wish it wasn't that way. But I guess the point that I was making last year and the point that I make again here, it wasn't malicious. It wasn't like folks said, let's exclude everybody else who's not working on this sacred material. It wasn't like that. It was just that people were so wrapped up in what they were doing and so excited by what they were doing that there wasn't a lot of energy or time left in the community to pay attention to things that were happening in the surrounding. And when it came to jobs, there were real implications for this. You know, in those days, more string theorists got the postdocs and got the faculty jobs because of the excitement. And you can well imagine that somebody who was working hard and doing really good work, but outside of string theory, maybe said, let me in. I want a job. Like, I want a postdoc. I get it. And I totally empathize with that. But it's just that when it's framed as though string theorists were like a malicious community that were sort of barring the doors against it, it wasn't like that at all. It was just coming from whatever, Alan Green's, you know, irrational exuberance, you know, it was exuberant. And was it irrational? Not irrational, but it was perhaps a little too much because the more seasoned researchers and physicists at that time knew that ultimately the excitement would die down and the theory would need to mature and be developed. And that's what we've been doing. So I think that's sort of my best answer, that it was coming from a good place. It wasn't coming from a place of exclusion.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.